Hello and welcome to the Quiver Channel. I am Jason, your host, and today we're going to tackle bipolar type 2, my other comorbidity, my other prime comorbidity. Making these videos is not easy. For one thing, focusing on one specific task is not easy. Bringing it all up to the surface is not either easy. Can be triggering. But when I explain to it from my point of view and how it affects me, I do it so that people have got examples. So people who are looking after someone who's got bipolar type 2 or someone who's been diagnosed with it. But I always say this, every single human being is unique. Every single person dealing with mental illness is unique. It's not like breaking an arm or having a specific disease that's in a specific way. Your life experiences, your gender, where you are in your life path will affect massively. Your support network will affect massively, or lack of a support network. But I always hope that there's something in here that can make you feel like you're not alone, or that the world isn't ending for you. Okay, let's start. Bipolar type 2. How I always best describe it was this. Almost my natural state is to be depressed. If we're doing it like this, this is you. Happy, sad, happy, sad, happy, sad, happy, sad. You might go have a birthday that bounces up, or a really good event, or you go to a favorite concert and you jump up in slightly bit in type and it's like crazy happy and that, but it's very fleeting. And then the sad stuff might be your pet dying or the loss of a loved one and that, and you'll go into depression and that. For me, I start off most of the time down here in depression. I spend most of my time in this, but I will spike up into what's called hypomania, a milder form of mania. Remember, my version of bipolar type 2 is a comorbidity. That means it's a part of my whole, which is autistic spectrum disorder, ADHD, and bipolar type 2. I spend a lot of my life fighting against a feeling of emptiness, of deep black and white. That's the best way to describe it. It's like all the colour, all the emotional colour, all the positive emotional colour, the bright light are muted and going away. And I feel like there's a black hole in the centre of my being. But let's go through this in parts. Depressed mood. Let's do it from this section. I've got notes. I've prepared for these ones. I've got notes. Let's deal with what's called the depressive episodes. Depressed mood or feelings of sadness, emptiness, or hopelessness. This can hit you at any time. And if you've got less energy to start with, and let's say my ADHD focuses on something negative, I can't turn away from it. It's focusing on something like, you could have done more for your wife before she died. You could have cured her cancer. You could have done this, 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 and this. You're a failure. You're a monster. You couldn't even save your own mother. All these kind of wonderful things. And they're the basics. And you're in remission from cancer. It'll come back one day. Your bowels are going to have thingy and they can't cut out anymore. And all these wonderful things. And 20 years of looking after Paola and second guessing myself. So it can also be based on completely illusions. It can be based on non-factual events. It can be based on your brain just going down a bad path. And this is why it's always good to talk to people. Even this, when I talk about these things, verbalizing it, externalizing it from me onto this thingy makes me look at you and say, that's silly. And gives me a little bit of a perspective. And talking to my friends on Discord about it and things like that when I'm having a bad time. I have so many coping strategies, so many ways to deal with this. But we're not talking about the way I cope with it. We're talking about how it feels. Feeling sad, when there's no reason for feeling sad. Feeling empty when your life is full. Sometimes I can just stop on the stairs, on the way downstairs, and I'll just feel as if I have nothing, nowhere to go. Why do I still keep making the effort? Now, I can be very objective. I can see a lot of it coming. My autism allows me to be objective. I mean, it's like I've got a perfect storm of some of the worst problems you can get that usually result in being heavily medicated, ended up in a psychiatric ward or an end-of-life event. But because of what I've been able to create coping-wise, I can cope. Feeling like it's just a lack of hope. And when you look at the world and all the bad things that are going on, it's very fucking easy to see that there's massive amounts of ammunition for that side of me. Massive amounts of ammunition for the darker side. And I deal with that all the time. Because bipolar type 2 means you spend most of your time, the depressive sides are much more frequent than the positive, the hypomania sides. It's not good. Loss of interests. Oh God, yes. This factors in with the ADHD as well, but very easy for my brain to just lose all. It's like I can be really interested in something and then my brain says zoom and pulls away all the fucking energy. All the energy that was intent and that for doing that, and I'm enjoying it, and it's a TV series I'm really enjoying, or it's a book I'm reading that I'm really enjoying, and all of a sudden zoom. It's like something just grabs all the energy, all the intent, and removes it from me, and I'm left. Rationally, I still want, but there's nothing there anymore. It's gone. You'll see a lot in this, in how it, you can see how certain things in the bipolar type 2 show up in ADHD as well in an adult. And so you can understand why the comorbidities thingy. Changing appetite or sleep pattern, chair. either overeating or undereating or not eating at all or eating to the point of making myself sick, which can be really bad anyway because of other things. Sleep patterns are fucking out the window, and you get that with ADHD as well. And it's just another layer of, if I lie down and my brain is still active in any way, fucking shape or form, when the silence hits me, that's when the bad stuff comes. When I start thinking of the bad stuff, when I'm this monster, when I shouldn't be around other people, when I bring more harm than positive sides, when I hurt more than I help. And even the tiniest little thing from my past, from when I was a fucking child at school, will come into my head and derail my chance of going to sleep. You end up napping more during the day. My coping strategies to do with sleep is this. If I want to fucking sleep, I'm going to go sleep. I don't fight it anymore. If I want to have a couple of naps during the day of an hour each that will help me survive a night where I only get 3 or 4 hours sleep, then damn right I'm going to have to do that. Because I need that energy to fight. I need to have a certain level of energy to be able to deal with all the crap that my brain throws at me. Fatigue and low energy. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. It isn't that, it's almost like the energy's been siphoned away to some other part of you that you don't have access to. It'll just go away. And it can happen any time. It's a hard thing to talk about the depressive episodes. It's because you can trigger it so easily. It's not good. It doesn't make you, it exhausts you. It exhausts you. You should try to fight against it. Difficulty concentrating and making decisions. Oh yes. I use stuff like Habitica. I mean, a normal person does not have to have a list of daily things that he has to do and have to have little tiny rewards that using the Habitica app, that little pings when I succeed in something, when I manage to do something. A normal person doesn't have to actually have a listed item here saying, playing an arcade game to remind me to make sure that I turn on my arcade machine and give myself a little break and play one of my retro games to give my brain a rest. I have to remind myself when I have to put it in here. Every single thing I do during the day, even going to the bathroom, has to be on my list. Having a wash. Remembering to go onto Facebook to just check on my sister. Remembering to look into Discord and actually read what it says on Discord and to check on my friends. I have to put all this in here and try to follow at least some of this every day. Feeling of guilt, worthlessness or helplessness. Oh yeah. Now this a lot of the time is based on completely illusionary, not real things, but that's bad enough as it is. Why you always have to talk to other people to get their input to their help. Because it's so hard to deal with that. You don't want to be dealing with it in an echo chamber. You don't want to be dealing with it alone. I'm very lucky that I've got this outlet that I've created. Even though it puts me in danger. Being so open about myself, it opens me up to massive problems and threats. But without it, I wouldn't be here. I have to be that open about it. I have to. I can't mask. I can't keep it in here. Not with all these other problems. No way. It would be a death sentence to do something like that. And when I talk about stuff that's illusionary but still hits you just the same, the idea that I could have cured my wife's cancer. I know rationally that the smartest people in the world in gene therapy and all that, in America, in Sweden, in Netherlands, and all over the world, I've been working on acute lymphoblastic leukemia with Philadelphia chromosome positive, and there's still, and the only treatment that looks as if it might have a chance, and this has come recently, is gene therapy, basically, where they remove that gene that causes that specific threatening issue. But that's still in the very early stages. Suicidal thoughts or behaviors. Woohoo! This is going to get... It's a good job my videos are never demonetized and anything like that. The mention, even mention of that, you're not supposed to talk about that side of it. That's why we call it the end of line events. I have many coping strategies so I don't go down. I say to people, I said, I do this so that bad things don't happen. And some of the time when I'm saying bad things don't happen, it isn't an external bad thing happening. Most of the time it's an internal bad thing happening. I've got to cut it off at the pass. I've got to make sure that my coping strategies are in the place. I've got to have things in place. For example, yeah, I still have those thoughts. But I count them. I can turn on my arcade machine behind me and go and play Space Invaders. I can close my eyes and listen to the sound of the arcade machine. And it can take me back to 1979 and 78. And I'm back in that chip shop in Tenby on holiday with my parents. And I'm spending all my money on this new fucking arcade machine that's just come from America and wasn't actually supposed to have even been bloody delivered to this little tiny fucking campsite and this little tiny chip shop in the corner. And even thinking about it makes me smile. As you can tell, it makes me smile, the thought of it. And I can go on and I can use things like that to try and so the bad things don't happen. That's the first part of bipolar type 2. Bipolar type 1 and bipolar type 2, these are horrible things, and even just dealing with those can massively destroy life. It's not a fun thing. It's not a... It doesn't really have positives, that side to it. Okay, let's get on to the second part. The hypermanic episodes. Woohoo! The hypermanic episodes. Oh, yes. Elevated mood, irritability, or euphoria, or all three at once. Holy shit. Oh, yeah. Anything can trigger these things. But because I'm bipolar type 2, the negative side, the darker side, the depression side is more common than the hyper side. The blips, but when they hit, I am a god. I can do anything, or I believe I can do anything. All my risk versus reward, all my rationale, safety concerns go out the window, and I am on a fucking roll, and I will do anything. And once again, I have to have lots of coping strategies to cope with this. Increased energy, activity, and restlessness. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's like someone's lit a fuse in your mind, and all of the energy you'd ever wanted is available, but you don't know what to do with it. You don't know what to focus on. You don't know where to go. You just know you've got to go. And you're like, you can accomplish anything. You can build chairs, you can put together things, you can clean the house, you can try to leverage it in a constructive way. But it doesn't, it's like you're on a fucking Bronco and trying to steer the fucking Bronco. It's a losing game. Reduced need to sleep. Basically, you don't sleep. No fucking way. If I'm in a hypermania, there is no fucking way I will get to sleep. There's not going to happen. Going to be walking around the house all night, doing different things, cleaning stuff, repairing stuff. May even go for a walk at 3 a.m. in the morning around my house and just keep going. Might decide, oh, it's 3 a.m. Why don't I get the quinger out and go on a mobility thing? Why don't we take the mobility scooter at 3 a.m. in the morning or things like that? Yes. Talkative and precious speeches. That's when you talk to someone and you keep talking to someone. And remember, this is not just on its own, because ADHD has these focuses on things that I'm really good at and things that I know a lot about. And I can tell when the hypomanic episode is kicking in, and I'm boring everybody else or exhausting everybody else because I can't get off the subject. And what do you mean by the pressure? You're forcing yourself into this on this, and you're doing it in a way that anybody else would find exhausting or daunting to listen to you, because you're not talking to your friends, you're talking at them, and it can be. I have lots and lots of things to deal with these things. Open mechanisms. Racing thoughts or flight of ideas. Oh, yes. You can succeed in anything when one of these hits. It's wonderful and bouncy and crazy and totally lacking in reality. But your mind doesn't care. You're basically the Flash. You're basically a god. You are Thor. You are Tony Stark. You can do anything. It's the euphoria of creativity. And it's not based in reality. Ah, fucking tall. It's not based in reality. Ah, fucking tall. Oh. Yeah, increased goal-directed activity or impulses. This is why I have so many projects ready to go. Can't wait to plan a project. You can't plan a project while in that mode. No, you've got to have it ready to go. You've got to have some multiple things ready to be sorted and ready to be acted on, so that you can just try to burn through this energy, burn it through in a safe way. And the coping strategies have to be there to stop you doing something monumentally stupid. Remember that side of ADHD that also has the impulsiveness and all that. Well, they mash together and it's... Distractibility or difficulty focusing. This is why you get this kind of merging between ADHD and bipolar. This is because when they're both on a roll, oh my god, it's like you're facing an insurmountable enemy that nothing will be able to stop. You're unstoppable. So, but you're both, your brain wants this hunger for goal directed and activities and that, but at the same time you have trouble focusing, and you can be distracted, and you'll end up with 5 or 6 projects done 10% instead of focusing on one. Increased involvement in activities with high potential for painful consequences. Examples with reckless spending, reckless sexual behavior. Oh, remember, pairing this with ADHD, pairing this with ADHD is like the 1-2 punch for your rationale, for your brain to keep stable, for you not to spend the money to not do certain things. I keep an amount of money in one of my games, Star Trek Online, my Zen. Just builds up over time because I've got a lifetime subscription to there. And I don't have to pay money, and I get 250-odd thingy. Well, I think 250 or 500 a month, something like that. And that just goes in. And this is what I spend money in games that won't affect my fucking credit rating, that won't fuck me over. I try to channel it towards that kind of thing. I have multiple games where I have massive amounts of funds in my games, and I try to use those to thing it, and I try to keep to certain rules. We'll talk about them. But yeah. Oh yes. The naughty side of myself really loves to come out in those situations. And this is why I have to have so many coping strategies. Thousands upon thousands of coping strategies for all of this to survive. Remember, I'm living alone at the moment, so I'm independent. I don't have an external force to guide me or someone who I'm responsible for. Other symptoms. Psychotic symptoms, such as hallucinations or delusions, may occur during episode of mania or depression, funnily enough. When I used to take Paola to the hospital, if I was having a issue, we didn't know at the time, I didn't know what was causing it, but I would see the hospital burning down, people dying. As we travelled there in the car, I would see two visions of the hospital. One, but in reality of what it was, as it was just there, this thing. And another, I would see patients burning, the car park on fire, the smoke, the screams. No, that wasn't good. Mood swings. Anybody who knows me knows that can hit. And it can, yeah, last for days, weeks, or months. I can be in a low or a high, or a low or a high. Knowing that you've got bipolar and being aware of the triggers, being aware of the early signs, you need to be able to create your coping strategies. You need to educate your mind and recognition of these things so that you can face them off. A lot of them coping strategies for my ADHD side. It isn't three compartments. My pie chart isn't split into three. There isn't autistic spectrum disorder, ADHD and bipolar down here. They're all one big ball of crazy. And they impact each other. This is why I always say bad things can happen. If I don't get a handle on things, if I don't have a coping strategy, if I don't fight back, if I don't counter things with certain things, like every single fucking thing in my room, in my house, in my safe space, right here, every single thing is a tool to fight against what I deal with. It's based on psychotherapy. It's based on lifestyle improvements. It's based on my doing. I don't do my Beat Saber. The side effect of my doing my Beat Saber every day and my other exercises I do every day is that it keeps me from getting way too over unhealthy. But the main reason is that the boost it gives me. Everything I do is, I don't play computer games because they're fun. I don't play computer games because they're a hobby. I play computer games as a survival. As pure fucking survival. No difference than if you were diabetic and you take insulin to survive. Or your kidneys are failing and you're on dialysis. When I turn on a fucking game, I am occupying a part of my brain. I am giving it a different way to cope, a different thing to do, so that bad things don't happen. Because we don't want the bad things to happen. And I have different layers of different coping strategies. I have final layers, what I call nuclear options, options I don't like, but I have all my normal coping strategies which help to stop things when they're in the early stages. Then I have another layer of coping strategies for when things are actually in there. Stuff like making sure that I remember by my take a breath routines. Basically, that means when I can fill my shopping cart with as many fucking items as I want on Amazon. I can go on a fucking day shopping experience on Amazon and put them all there. But I never press the checkout button. I wait. I wait 24 hours. I wait 36 hours. I wait 48 hours until and decide, is this because of I really want this, or is this because my brain is just fucking grabbing at shiny? And then I have other layers of things like going over there to that arcade machine. When people think, see that arcade machine in my background, they think, ooh, yeah, he's so fucking lucky. So also he's got that. I mean, I wish I could have that and that. That fucking thing behind me saves my life. That fucking arcade machine saves my life. When things are getting really bad, I can shift myself back to being 9 years old. And I have lots of scenarios like that, that I can use with my Amiga, with my Spectrum 48K, with other things. That's where the retro stuff comes in. Even though I love retro stuff, the retro stuff can take me into my past, to a time when I was sitting in front of a Mega Drive, or sitting in my mum's house in Bentley and playing Dungeon Master on my Amiga 500. And things like that can grab me and alter my brain chemistry and help. And I have my nuclear options that are like the ultimate things. And people don't talk about it enough. I mean, fucking hell. People don't talk about it enough, but one of the best things to do to leverage. And yes, no, we are going to talk not safe for work for a few minutes here. Why the fuck do you think I have so many hentai games? And that. You can leverage your libido, your lust, your desires, your fetishes, call them what they will, in a safe way to burn off some of that energy, to distract your mind. I call it a nuclear option because it is the last level of thinking. The thing is, your lust, your desires, your libido have what I call super user permissions in your brain. they override most things. It's like we say, don't do shopping when you're hungry, and don't make decisions when you're horny. Because they can be bad decisions. But yeah, it isn't talked enough, but fucking hell. Masturbation can be an amazing, amazing way of dealing with depression and darkness. And always an amazing way to get rid of the positive, the mania, the manic, hypomanic energy as well. So yeah, that's the not safe for work side. People don't talk about it. Therapists will tell you about it. Well, people don't talk about it. It's a taboo subject, but that is another thing that will help, even just for a small amount of time. But you have to find your own way. You have to find your own coping strategies. And maybe medication will work for you. And therapy could work for you. And cognitive therapy can help. And having friends and having people around you and not having to cope with it all alone. So hopefully, as you're seeing, the because I have both ADHD, bipolar type 2, and autistic, they all mix together. They amplify each other. But I also, my autistic side and my affinity to technology and my love of technology and my technology being my, the love of my life means I can leverage that technology in ways most people can't. Which is why in 2019, my head mental therapist, when he read my files and everything, asked me how I was still alive. Or as he put it, how the fuck are you still alive? And I still remember that moment because I was so pissed off at him. Because I was in a bad place, I was ready to end it. People weren't, nothing to anybody. All these fucking therapies they were trying with me weren't working because they were trying the things that would help with my, they were trying to treat my ADHD separate from my bipolar and my bipolar separate from something else. And I still remember exactly walking into his office and sitting down and thinking, another fucking new expert trying to tell me how to fix all this. I was so angry and combative in that. When I first got in that room, I'd had to wait for like 3/4 of an hour because they had overbooked. Of course, they had overbooked. I was sitting down in that fucking office. And I was just, I was ready to tear this person a new one. I was mentally writing my diatribe in my head of what I was going to fucking say to this guy. I was going to go off on him. I was angry, I was depressed, I was upset, I was nearing the end. I was, nothing worked, no one was helping me. All these fucking things that they had me tried were making me feel even worse. And through that anger, through that hate of me just sitting there, unable to sit still, and the fucker is doing that thing they do where they take your notes out and they read them while you're there. Why the fuck couldn't he have read it before I got there? And now I know he was actually doing it intentionally. And he just, and it cut through everything that I was dealing with, every pain and suffering, every bit of anger and depression and hate, self-hatred and that. It just basically stopped me in my tracks. When he just put my medical records down, looked at me and said, how the fuck are you still alive? And then, as I took a breath, and was totally stunned and because this was not what I expected him to say. Not what I expected him to say. He followed that with his, I've sadly looked after many patients in the past with like 10% of what you're dealing with. And sadly, we weren't able to help them. And he looked really sad. And I knew then that we had lost patients, lost people who we tried to help. And that's when we started talking about technology, about how computers made me feel. And basically he threw out all of the standard therapies, the standard situations, and said, okay, let's try this. Let's try this. That's another thing. Get yourself a fucking therapist that actually listens. Not all therapists fit all people. They don't. And if you have the chance, if your therapist isn't someone who is actively helping you, who actively making you feel better, then if you have the choice, find a new therapist. Find a new mental health professional. I know some people don't have the luxury of that, but if you do, find that person that understands, that listens to you and forms their theories and their practical help based on who you are, not on what their book says. Yes, this kind of thing exhausts me. My next time I do one of these, it'll be autism spectrum disorder we'll deal with. And these three videos, these three primary videos that talk about all of this, gives you an understanding of who I am, of what I deal with daily. And how fucking amazing it is that I can actually function. So this is Jason for the Weber channel. I hope you're all having a good... Oh my god, we've gone to 43 minutes. I specifically put this window behind another window because I didn't want to focus on the actual time and derail myself. So this is Jason for the Queber channel. I hope you're all having a wonderful day. Bye bye for now.